things down. So in my engagement with this young lady, it was very easy to help her go through the college process. She ended up applying to college. Because she applied early in the cycle, it gave her an opportunity to receive scholarships. The young lady came to St. Peter's College. She was actually one of my first recruits to come to the college. While she was there, I took it very seriously. I wanted to make sure she was successful. So I helped her get a job in the office. She actually brought me a copy of her first report card as a college student. It's about over 3.5, she made the dean's list. And we just stayed in contact throughout the time that she graduated. So when she called me and asked me to come and speak to her class, I said, of course I would do that because she was one of my favorites. So I just want to let you know that she's the example that she is right now to you guys in the studio. She was that way when she was actually sitting in your seat. So you have a wonderful teacher. She cares about you guys. So that's why I tracked down here to come and say hi, good morning, and spend some time with you. So I'm afraid the framework for our conversation is, what does tomorrow look like? So that's what I want you to start pondering. When you graduate from high school, you start to make the different steps, the machinations of life, what does that look like? Do you go into college? Do you get a job where you start to work? Working in a career? Do you start with every day you get up, you go to work, you come home, you do whatever you do after work, you go to sleep, you wake up, and you do it again? That's a possible, that's an outcome. A lot of people in our society do that. And I think that you guys can do that along with other things. Going to college is a great opportunity to expand your world. Now, what do I mean by that? I'm from Jersey City. Jersey City, during the time I grew up there, was probably one of the worst cities in the country. I grew up below the poverty line. So when I went off to college, I was able to meet people that were from a myriad of backgrounds. I met a person that was from different parts of Europe, from Africa. I was in class with an African prince. I went to visit some of these places. So in doing those things, I started to expand my worldview and realize that there are bigger places, more places in the world than where I was from, that little small urban enclave. Does that make sense? So as I entered into college, one of the things that's important is that I did not know who I thought I knew what I wanted to study. I wanted to study accounting. The reason why I wanted to study accounting is because I wanted to make a lot of money in my own world. Anybody on that track right now? Me too, right? I was there. Own the world. But when I started accounting classes, I realized that accounting wasn't exactly what I was excited about as a passion. So I moved over to management. I kept the accounting, moved over to management. When I graduated undergrad, I then went into a double master's degree program. I have a master's in business administration and a master's in information systems. And finishing my master's degree is when I started working in college admissions. I'm very happy about that transition because I got to meet some wonderful young people over the years of working in college admissions. One of the things that's so interesting is when I look at you at your age, I can remember sitting in that seat. Now, for me, that was a long time ago. I still remember it. I still remember the uncertainty. I still remember procrastination. I still remember thinking I got a ton of time that's left. So I didn't go into college working at the top pace or being ready to move and transition right into what college had to offer. I started out at Virginia State University, had a great time. But after my junior year, I realized academically, I need to go home and be in a more stable environment. So I made a somewhat mature decision and came home and finished. The rest academically is history. So just because you make the decision to go to college doesn't mean that you're automatically going to be successful. There's these different transitions that happen in your life. That makes sense? So as you transition, you have to be prepared at each moment that you transition. The number one way that you can prepare yourself right now is make a decision about tomorrow. So if tomorrow for you is going to college and you haven't applied to college yet, you haven't taken the SATs, you haven't taken the academic, you haven't done those things, you put yourself behind. Now it's not over, you just put yourself behind. What I recommend if you're thinking about tomorrow is to start putting these things in place. Now, as a resident of New York. You guys have great, two great systems that are there for you, CUNY and SUNY. Your college is a part of CUNY, but let's be clear about something. If you think that you can wait until April or May and apply to CUNY and gain acceptance into the top schools in CUNY, I'm here to tell you that's not gonna happen. So if you're thinking about Baruch and Hunter and Brooklyn, et cetera, City, these types of places, understand that they have an allotted amount of seats in their class. And those seats are filling up now. So now is the time to make sure that you apply, submit the applications, because it creates opportunities for you. How many of you have heard of the Excelsior Scholarship? Can you tell me what the Excelsior Scholarship is?
Basically, they pay, the city will pay, or I think it might be the state actually. If your parents make less than $125,000 a year, they will pay for a certain, like up to a certain amount of your tuition for your college education.
Yes, that's pretty close. So understand that the tuition to go to CUNY, for example, is approximately $6,500 per year. That's tremendous. So let me say it again, $6,500 per year. Excelsior is a scholarship that will go on top of any other financial aid or scholarships that you receive. So it's the combination of all the different aid that you receive that creates opportunities for students to go to school for free. So to graduate undergrad with zero debt is amazing. But the key to, one thing to keep in mind is that no matter what school you go to, if it's private, if it's public, if it's in-state, out-of-state, you want to try to maximize or graduate with the least amount of student debt as possible. Does that make sense? Okay. So now we got the college. We got the college piece kind of out of the way. Now let's continue to talk about what does tomorrow look like. Now, how many of you can think back to decisions you made 4 years ago and how those decisions are impacting you right now? It can be positive. I'm not just talking about negative, any type of negative decision, but even some positive decisions that are impacting you right now. Can you think of those? How many of you realize that in the eighth grade you were making decisions that can impact or have an impact on if you go to college or not? How many of you realize that in the eighth grade? Excellent. So from my research, what I found is that students start to make substantive decisions in the seventh and eighth grade about how they're going to live their life. But in the seventh and eighth grade, many times you're not prepared to understand or mature enough to understand what those decisions mean. Does that make sense? Can someone articulate to me what I just said? Yes?
Basically, like, we make decisions when we're late into middle school that we can't understand how they could affect us for getting down.
Sure. Pretty good. Excellent, excellent. But the key is you can't go back to the eighth grade, but now think about what decisions are you making right now that can impact your life and how it's going to impact your life 4 years from now. Now, through all of my education, I made a ton of mistakes. Right? So it'd be easy for me to step in front of you as the person I am now. And the projection is, you know, if I'm gonna tell you I'm from Jersey City, you won't know that. Right? If I didn't tell you I grew up in poverty, you wouldn't know that. If I didn't tell you I made mistakes and actually got kicked out of the Jersey State, you wouldn't know that. But it's important for me to share those things with you because I'm an example of what happens on the other side. So when you make these mistakes, you can rebound from them. But you have to position yourself to make sure that you're walking on the path towards what your aim is on. So eventually I started to figure out and click at my senior year at St. Peter's College. I understood, I started to think about what does tomorrow look like. But there were six words that had haunted me from my senior year through that point. And I learned it from a soliloquy from Hamlet, and it's to thy own self be true. So what I was trying to figure out, I'm this Jersey City guy. Why am I in college as a student? That's silly, but that's what I was thinking. Because I was never a hardcore thug in the street guy, ever. I was never that guy. Yet when I was in college, I was pondering, if I'm from Jersey City, why am I in college? Right? Because I never had anyone that just got to get in front of me and literally say to me what I'm saying to you right now. It's okay if that's what you want to do. So to that own self be true clicked when I became a senior in college. I realized exactly what the path I wanted to follow. But here's the problem, or here was the issue for me at the time. I had to transition and continually transition from my starting block to where I can foresee myself in the future. Does that make sense? Every time I transitioned, I left someone behind. Every time I transitioned, I left a way of thinking behind. Every time I transitioned, these best friends that I had, they weren't transitioning at the same rate or at the same time. So, here's the deal. There's two things you can do in that situation. You can push forward, or you can slow yourself down. That's a rhetorical question, you don't have to raise your hand. But how many of you slowed yourself down academically, the way you're moving in life because you don't want to leave somebody behind? That's the worst thing that you can do. And I tell you that because I've done that myself. Never slow yourself down. Because eventually you're going to get to that point anyway. So those relationships and different things that may change because you're transitioning and you're moving, because what happens if you keep moving, this is what happens. You're going to rise. It's just a part of it. But here's the tough part. What if it's your family you have to transition from? What if it's your mother, or father, or brother, cousin, best friend you've known your whole life? What if that's the trend? That's when you're going through those transitions. What does that feel like? What does that look like? So when I say, what does tomorrow look like? Those are the things I need you to start pondering, because I experienced that. I can let you know that being a scholar is a lonely endeavor. Because when you're on the road to becoming a scholar, there are not many people that understand the rigor that's involved in training your mind in this regard. About 1.5% of people in America have a PhD. And it's probably about half of a percentage point of African Americans in this country that have a PhD. Of that half of 1%, it's probably about 0.01% of 1% that an African American knows. So for me to even think that I can earn a PhD was unfathomable to me. And I had many people who told me, why are you trying to do that? Why are you trying to become a doctor? What does that mean? That's cool. Why are you trying to do these are family, not last time, but when I was that age, I hated it. I used to be called college boy all the time. Hated it. But something in me kept me pushing. And that's why if you take nothing away from what I say today, here's the way to sum it all up for you. Never slow yourself down. It is okay to succeed. It is okay to be different. You should strive to be different. And what you want in life, you can achieve if you're willing to put the work in. But when you get there, that means that you've transitioned to a level and a place that's different from who you were before. Does that make sense? So when I go back to my neighborhood, I'm still a Toro. Still that same guy when I go to my neighborhood. But it's different when I go back to my neighborhood. The way I look at things is different. The way I understand things are different. The way I interact with the community is different. But the beauty of my community is that they represent and they love what I am today. Because they want me to push down in the youth in the community as much as possible the same lessons and travails that I had to go through. So, with 5 degrees, I'm going to tell you that I'm not Superman. I'm not anybody special in that way. I'm not trying to impress you in any kind of way. What I'm simply trying to tell you that if you want to be able to determine who you work for, how you work, when you work, where you work, education is the key and a way to be able to get that done. One thing I have, I believe has set me apart from some of my peers, is that I have options. If my life was to change up in a career instance right now, I'm very confident that I can quickly move into another career. Not a job, a career. I enjoy what I do. I enjoy talking to young people. And I'll tell you one last thing, and then I'm gonna open up for questions if you're interested in asking questions. I remember my first presentation was at a school, it wasn't too far from here, Notre Dame Academy, I think was the name of the school. And it was an all-girls school.
It's a private school.
Say it again?
It's a private school.
Yes, private school. All-girls school, there's probably about 25 young ladies in the class. I'm about 23, 24. I'm giving this presentation, they're smiling, but they're not paying, I don't think they paid attention. And I was so like, blown, I was just destroyed after I left that presentation. I didn't think that, I was just like, I didn't do a good job, didn't care what I was saying. And it was one young lady that was in the class. Her name was Melissa Maldonado. And Melissa, like Ms. Richardson, applied to the school. They received, both of them received this kind of like a Burrow scholarship we had. And Melissa didn't end up coming to St. Peter's College. She actually went to NYU, and I encouraged her to go to NYU. The reason why was because she was a Latin singer, and the program she was entering into at NYU could help develop her craft in a way that I knew that St. Peter's College could not. But she wrote me a note. And I still have it with Ms. Richardson's first report card on my board. And she basically said that, Mr. Yates, thank you for coming to my school, because before you came to the school, I didn't think I could go to college. So not only am I going to college, I received scholarships to go to college. And that really struck me, because again, in that day, during that presentation, I didn't think what I said mattered, but it does. Now, why am I telling you that? Because when you leave this classroom today, when you go into other classes, when you're walking down the hallways, when you're talking to your younger siblings, friends, it matters. Start a movement building a drive to thrive. I'm just gonna say that again. Start a movement that's a drive to thrive. And again, one last thing, and I know I said the last thing was the last thing. This is really the last thing. I'm gonna say this the right way. I'm a nerd, right? And I'm happy to be that. But you have to understand, so I was an All-American football player since I was a little kid. So when I was in school, I hid that I was a nerd. I was actually one of the quote-unquote cool kids, right? But the cool kids that I was around almost 30 years ago, really not that cool now. It's the nerds that's ruling. So I actually be a nerd with me. Let's do it, all right? I'd like to thank you for giving me an opportunity to talk to you. It was a pleasure. Let's talk about it, all right?